It's a great pleasure to be back here. I know many people already. So this talk is about equilibrium competition in market. So market we deal in our everyday, in our day-to-day life. So this is a vegetable market, stock market, currency exchange market, and more recently online market. So the basic question here is how the price of a good is determined. Why some good is more costlier than the other? So let's take an example of single good. So at higher prices, supply is more because like more people are ready to produce it. Okay, so supply curve here like this. Supply curve is like this. At higher prices, there is more supply because more people are ready to produce it for you. But the demand behaves in opposite way. At higher prices, demand is less because less number of people will be buying this one. And when these two come meet, then we call it an equilibrium. So here P star is the equilibrium price of this good and Q star is the demand of this good as well as supply of this good. So at equilibrium, demand equals supply. So this was about the single good. But when there are more than one good, so suppose you want to have a dessert and you have two choices, ice cream and cake. Now the demand of ice cream depends on the price of cake. It is not simple anymore because these two goods are substitutes. Because like both satiate your desire of having dessert. And this theory has been studied since centuries. So earliest work by Adam Smith in 1700, who was advocate of free market economy. He also coined the term called invisible hand of the market. So what he said that it is not from the benevolence of the baker that we expect our dinner, but from their regard to their own interest. So he says that like when everyone is behaving rationally and selfishly, then market automatically operates at an equilibrium. And later in 1874, Leon Walras, who is considered father of general equilibrium theory, he was the first one to mathematically formulate the market. And in fact, he gave an algorithm to compute market equilibrium, which he called tettlement. So algorithm is very natural. It's very simple. You start with some prices and calculate the demand. If the demand of some good is more than its supply, then you increase its prices. And if the demand is less than its supply, then you decrease the prices. When it will converge, then that will be the equilibrium. So he gave this dynamics, which will converge at an equilibrium. However, he didn't prove that every market will converge to an equilibrium. If not, then under what conditions it will converge? Another famous economist of the same time, Irving Fisher, he in fact built a hydraulic computer to compute an equilibrium. So this is the 19th century computer to compute an equilibrium. When the water level is stabilized, then you get equilibrium. So this was just the beginning of the beautiful theory of market equilibrium. So the plan of this talk is I'll mathematically define what are markets and the notion of equilibrium. And then from a series of remarkable work, now we have a clear dichotomy in equilibrium computation. So I'll show you that. And then I'll show you one algorithmic result and one hardness result. And then I'll briefly talk about some of my other works in markets. So that is the plan. So let's start with markets and equilibrium. So in the market, so there are a set of goods and a set of agents. And feel free to ask me question if something is not clear. Each agent brings some goods to market and given prices of these goods, agents sell their goods and earn some money. And from the earned money, they want to buy a bundle which they prefer the most. And it should be also affordable because they have the limited amount of money. So this is called optimal bundle. So when they are doing something like this, then it also happens that demand of every good meets its supply. Because like at some prices, demand of some good is more than its supply because they prefer something. Then If it also happens that demand meets supply, then we call it an equilibrium. So this is the notion of equilibrium. And for optimal bundles, there is a utility function. We can associate the preference of every agent by utility function. And optimal bundle is obtained by maximizing this utility function and it is assumed to be concave because it models law of diminishing marginal returns. So for example, you want to have an ice cream. For the first scoop you have some happiness, for the second scoop your happiness decreases, and maybe like fourth, fifth scoop your happiness may be negative, or you are even ready to pay for not consuming it. So this is the assumptions on utility function of agent.
So the agents also bring money, or they just bring goods?
They bring goods, but
it's any
barter economy. Off single barter. Yeah, this is like barter system. So it's like exchange market. But any other market, like with the money, you can convert into this market. Because money can be another good. Or there are many ways to. So this is the most general market model. Most of the market can be converted into this model. And this is given by Arundhati Group. Okay, let's take a simple example. So suppose there are three goods, orange, apple and mango, and there are two agents. Let's call them Bunty and Bubbly. And Bunty brings like 1 kilo of apple and 1 kilo of mango. And Bubbly brings like 1 kilo of orange and 1 kilo of mango. So this is what they bring to the market. This is their initial bundle. And their utility function is like, what they want to consume, orange and mango in equal proportion. Suppose they want to have a juice for which they want both of them in equal proportion. So that is what they want to consume. And here like Bubbly is like apple and mango. So she wants, her utility function is she wants to consume apple and mango in equal proportion. Okay. So suppose prices of goods are 1, 2 and 1. 1 rupee for orange, 2 rupee for apple and so on. So at these prices, earning of Bundy is like he has 1 kilo of apple and 1 kilo of mango. So 2 plus 1, 3. So 3 rupees he can earn by selling his initial bundle. And similarly, Bubbly can earn 2 rupees by selling her initial bundle of orange and mango. So this is their initial earning at these prices. So what is demand? So at these prices, since he doesn't want to consume apple, so demand of apple is zero. He doesn't like apple. And what will be the demand of orange mango? Because like he has 3 rupees, and he wants to consume like orange and mango in equal proportion. And the price of orange and mango is 1 each. So it's like 3 divided by 2. So 3 by 2 kilos of orange he will demand, and 3 by 2 kilos of mango. So here like this is an example, that's why this is a simple utility function, but it can be very complicated. And similarly we can compute the demand of Bubbly, and that will turn out to be like 2/3 of mango, 2/3 of apple and 0 kilo of orange. So this is the demand of these two agents at these prices. Because at these prices they earn some money, and from the earned money they want to maximize their utility function. And utility function can be very complicated. We have just taken some example where they want to consume in this fashion. Okay. So now what is the total demand of apple? So total demand of apple is like 0 plus 2/3, which is 2/3. And the total supply is 1 unit, because only Bunty brings 1 unit, 1 kilo of apple. So demand is less than supply. And the demand of mango is more than supply, because like the total demand is more than 2 and supply is 2. So it is more than supply. So demand is not equal to supply, so this is not an equilibrium prices. So these prices are not equilibrium prices. Suppose the prices are 1, 1, 2, we can do the same calculation again, and we can see that like they will earn 3 rupees each, and they will demand like this. So, and here demand matches supply. So this is an equilibrium. So equilibrium is like you demand at the current prices whatever you want to consume, which is affordable. And demand meets supply. So these two constraints should be satisfied. So we get an equilibrium. So here this is an equilibrium. So any question about the notion of equilibrium? I hope this is clear. So here this was a very simple market. There were like three goods, two agents, and the utility function is also very simple. And we were able to start with some prices, and in the end we were able to get the equilibrium prices. But why this should be true for every market? And the complicated utility function, any concave utility function. And in fact, this was the celebrated theorem by Arundhati Group from 1954, where they established the existence of equilibrium using fixed point theorem. So they prove that there always exists an equilibrium, given any market and any utility function. But their proof was using fixed point theorem, and fixed point theorem is like this. You have a square and you have a continuous function from this square to itself. So you have a continuous function. So you take any continuous function from square to itself, there will always exist a point in this square which is fixed by this function. So there is a point here, A, which is fixed by this function, fi equals I. So you take any continuous function, this will always be there. There will be always some point A. So this is what fixed point theorem says. So Aaron to prove what they did, they formulated the market Equilibria problem as a fixed point problem. And since fixed point problem, there always exists a fixed point. So it proves the existence of market Equilibria via fixed point theorem. However, it doesn't give us any way to compute this point. So it doesn't give us any algorithm, any procedure by which we can compute this point. It is just an existential result, non-constructive. But we are interested in computing market Equilibrium because we want to use it. We want to use it for policy analysis, for online markets, for many other problems which can be formulated through market Equilibrium notion. And computation is very important. In the words of Scott, he says that due to non-existence of efficient algorithms for computing Equilibria, general Equilibrium analysis has remained at a level of abstraction and mathematical theorizing far removed from its ultimate purpose as a method for the evaluation of economic policy. So of course computation is important. So one way is to just put a grid on the domain of the function and maybe check on every point of the grid whether it gives a fixed point or near to fixed point. Maybe that is also okay. If this does not give us anything, then maybe refine this grid and do the same calculation again. In fact, Scarf and Smith uses something similar like this, an approach similar like this to find approximate fixed point. And using this, they were able to get something in market Equilibrium. However, the algorithm is slow and there are issues of numerical instability. In spite of all these, it has been used in practice, this algorithm, Scarf and Smith. Okay, so computation of market Equilibrium depend on utility functions. What you assume about the utility function of agent, it is very much dependent on that. So if we assume that the utility function is linear, so linear means your utility from one mango is like if you consume one mango, then your utility is 1 unit, let's say. For the second mango, you get again the 1 unit of happiness. So it was linear. And similarly, you have a linear utility from apple. Here it can be any constant. Here, let's, in this example, it is like 2 units of happiness from consuming one apple, and so on. And for the second apple also, you have the same 2 units of happiness. And so like this, you have like a linear utilities for every good. And the total utility is like how much mango, your utility from mango plus utility from apple plus utility from orange. So this is your total utility. So here like 1 times, so because 1 is the utility you get by consuming one unit of apple, mango. So 1 times amount of mango plus 2 times. So I'm just writing this in mathematical way. So, and there has been a huge amount of work for studying linear utility functions. So this is not an exhaustive list. So these are just some papers which I have in mind. So, and now we have polynomial time algorithms to compute market Equilibrium where every agent has linear utility function. But it does not satisfy diminishing marginal return. So it is far away from the real utility function. Okay, so let's try to generalize this. So this was linear utility function. So what you do, you make it piecewise linear concave. So now utility function of first apple, okay, so from first apple you get 2 units of happiness. From the second apple, your happiness decreases. Now you get only 1 unit of happiness, and so on. So you have made linear into piecewise linear concave. Concave because like your utility is decreasing. So it goes linear till some amount, then it decreases the rate of utility, and then again it goes linear, and then again. So it's like piecewise linear concave.
Assumption that diminishing will be marginal, in a sense it may not be diminishing jointly.
So yeah, so this is separable. You can talk about, so there are utility functions which can which satisfy those condition that it can be joint. Then it is called non-separable. I'm coming to it. Okay, so this is piecewise linear concave. So you have piecewise linear concave utility, from every good. And you have piecewise linear concave from every good, and total utility is sum over all these goods. So it is separable because the utility is separate for each good. So you have a utility from consuming apple, from consuming mango separately. In our example, we want it was not separable because agents like Bhante and Bhavite wanted to consume goods in equal proportion. Okay, so this is the I think natural generalization from linear, which satisfies diminishing marginal returns. So it is of course more realistic, but there are no polynomial time algorithms known for this problem. Even for two segments, even the utility has only two linear segments, then also this problem is was shown to be intractable. Okay, so non-separable utility, so this was separable, you have separate utility function for each good. And in the non-separable, you have utility from bundle of goods. Like you want to buy charger or iPad together. So you don't have utility from only charger, because what will you do with the charger? So there are goods for which you want to consume together. So these are like called complement goods in economics. So here like if someone wants to consume mango and apple in equal proportion, so there is no utility by consuming only mango, no utility by consuming only apple. Only utility you get when you consume both of them together. So it is called non-separable. And piecewise linear concave, which is the most general utility function, can have any combination of separable plus non-separable. So you can model, I think, anything, any preference of any agent. And it is, of course, it contains separable, so it is intractable, but its exact complexity is obtained in these three papers. What is the exact complexity?
So it's intractable in the number of goods and the number of...
So if you assume that the number of goods are constant, then it is polynomial, there is a polynomial time.
And if the number of agents is...
No, it's an open problem. If the number of agents are constant, then we don't know. But if both are general, then of course it is intractable. Okay, so these are the three classes I will be talking about: linear, SPLC and PLC. So we want to get an algorithm, fast algorithm for PLC utility function. Because that way we can model the real preferences, any preferences.
What about the case of linear but non-separable?
Linear plus non-separable. So it's like it is also, so we show that it comes inside PLC, but it is, the hardness is same as PLC. So the example I took, like where you want to consume both of goods together, so that is kind of linear plus non-separable, because like there is no diminishing returns. So we show that that utility function, which I will be covering in this talk. And so it seems that utility function is the most difficult one. That is the most difficult one. So I'll come to that thing. Okay, this is the...
Are there cases of in the non-separable, will there be a case of, I don't know how to put it, the x-axis going non-linearly? So for example, the first point in the x-axis is one iPad, one charger.
Right.
Second point is two iPads, one charger.
Yeah, so
that's also possible?
I defined that kind of utility function.
Okay.
This is some of my work. So there was no utility function for that, but I just like, so it is called Leontief.
Okay.
So Leontief is an economist who defined this function where you want to consume goods in that proportion. So, but there is no diminishing returns. But if you make them pieces, like initial, like to till some amount, let's say first charger, first iPad, you have some utility from on the second segment. Maybe you can have same ratio of these goods, or maybe different ratio, but maybe your rate decreases. So those can be modeled, and everything comes inside PLC. You can model everything in PLC. It should be just concave. That is So we have polynomial time algorithms for linear, and it is intractable, and this is of course intractable. But the intractability of these two problems are different. So I'll come to that. So they are like, of course this is more harder than SPLC.
Yeah, I understand. Same for PLC, even if you could fragment objects, for example, take quarter of an apple or slice it into small portions.
Yeah, yeah, it is like divisible goods. The goods are divisible in my talk.
Oh, the goods.
I should have mentioned it earlier, but goods are divisible. Infinitely divisible. Okay, so what is the complexity class we know? P and NP. So P is the class of problems where solutions can be found in polynomial time, like linear programming. You can solve efficiently on your computer in polynomial time. And NP is the class of problems where solutions can be verified in polynomial time. So it contains hard problems like traveling salesman problem, quadratic programming, those type of problems. And the problems we ask here is like, these are the decision classes, like whether there exists a solution or not. So we ask yes and no questions in these classes. But in market equilibrium case, solution always exists. There is no question to ask whether there exists an equilibrium or not. Because by error to truth theorem, equilibrium always exists. So you cannot ask such a question. So Megiddo in 88 showed that if these problems are NP hard, where solution always exists, all instances are yes instances, then NP equals 0.P, which we don't believe to be true. So NP hardness is ruled out for these problems. So we want to prove that these are intractable, but NP is not the right class to prove the intractability of these problems. So Papadimitrov in 94 defined a complexity class called PPAD, which looks similar to his like substring of his last name. So earlier I thought like that, but they found out that it stands for polynomial parity argument for directed graphs. So he proved that approximate fixed point is PPAD complete. So if you want, so approximate fixed point is like fx minus x is within some epsilon 1. So finding such a point x is PPAD complete. It's hard. And the solutions are rational. So rational means like you can compute them exactly. Like P upon Q. So all the prices are like this. All the fixed points are like this. But what about the complexity of computing exact fixed point? Fx equals x. Equals x. And the thing is that these two notions, like approximate fixed point and the exact fixed point, can be very, very far away. So there may be approximate fixed point sitting somewhere, but it may be nowhere near to any exact fixed point. So for the exact fixed point, Etesami and Yanagakis defined a complexity class called fixed P. And here the solutions can be irrational but algebraic. So it is like, of course, exact fixed point contains approximate fixed point. So fixed P contains PPAD. So these are the two classes defined for the problem where solutions are directly to exist. So let's see where they stand in the traditional complexity classes, PN. So PPAD is inside NP, functional class of NP, but it is not known to be in polynomial time. And fixed P is even not known to be in NP, it may be harder than NP, it is believed to be harder than NP, but everything sits inside P space. So, and fixed P of course contains PPAD. So this is the current status of these complexity classes. And now due to a lot of work in computer science, we now have a very striking dichotomy in market equilibrium computation between separable PLC utilities and PLC utilities. PLC is the most generalizability function. So for separable PLC, SPLC, all equilibria are rational. Computing one is PPAD complete. There is a practical algorithm in the style of simplex, like which moves from vertex to vertex. And decision version is NP complete. Because there always exists a solution, but if you ask a non-trivial decision problem, whether there exists more than one equilibrium. So this is a non-trivial. So those are NP complete problems. And for PLC, solutions are irrational but algebraic. The complexity of finding one is fixed P complete. There is no non-practical algorithm known for this. And the decision version is ETR complete, which is where ETR stands for existential theory of reals. So these three are our result, and I'll now show you some briefly these two results, the algorithm and the hardness. And amazingly, we have a similar dichotomy, analogous dichotomy in Nash equilibrium computation. So I am not covering Nash equilibrium, but just to mention that we have analogous dichotomy between computing Nash equilibrium and two player game and more than two player games. So we have analogous dichotomy here. Okay, so that was the markets and equilibrium and dichotomy. If you have any questions, then I can answer. Otherwise, I can move to any one. Okay. So all these algorithms in the Nash equilibrium computation or market equilibrium computation are based on the techniques from linear complementarity problem and Lemkin algorithm. So let me briefly review these techniques. It is little bit technical, but like it won't take more than like 5 minutes. So just stay with me. Okay, so the LCP problem is like this. We have given a matrix M and a vector Q. Find y such that it satisfies these three constraints. So first constraint is linear inequalities, like in LP. And the last constraint is like non-linear constraints, which is like complementarity constraint. If you are familiar with complementary slackness of LP, so it is something like that. So you have a complementarity between variable and the constraint. So you are pairing them up. Okay, so these two constraints are easy constraints because these are like linear programming. The problem is these non-linear constraints. These are quadratic constraints. So, okay, so this is the problem we want to solve. So, just to simplify writing, I will write these complementarity with this symbols.
M sub I are rows.
M sub I is the ith row of M. Yes. Okay, so it captures, it generalizes linear programming, convex quadratic programming. So you can formulate them as an LCP. And there are many other problems from engineering and like wherever you have complementarity type constraint, then the LCP is a natural thing to try. Okay, so here every solution is at a vertex of the polyhedron. So rationality follows. If the input is rational numbers, then output is also rational. And there can be disconnected set of solutions. So this is like unlike LPs and convex programming, where the solutions are connected and convex set. So here the solutions can be disconnected. And even there, they may not exist one. There may not exist any solution. And it also captured knapsack type of problem. So it is NP-hard in general. So how to find a point in, how to solve this LCP? So possible method is, so you can start from some vertex in the polyhedron. So this is a little bit technical, but let me, for the interest of those people. So you can easily find one vertex. It's like solving LP. But it is not clear how to pivot from this vertex to another vertex so that you end up on like one of the solution vertices. So Lemke gave an idea. So what his idea was? So we want to solve this LCP.
So when was Lemke?
64. 1964. Okay, so what he did, he introduced one new scalar variable. So we want to solve this system, but he like introduced one more dimension, one more variable, extra variable, and he considered this problem. And what happened that you can show that solutions of the second problem with the new variable equals 0 is same as solutions of 1. So we are interested in finding solutions of 1, which is same as finding solutions of 2 with j equals 0. So this can be easily checked. Okay, so it looks like that you have made the problem more difficult by introducing one more dimension, but it helps actually. So what happens now? So let's see how the solutions of 2 look like. So they are now set of paths and cycles. So paths are like either going infinity on both the direction. If it is stopping at a vertex, then that vertex has j equals 0, z equals 0, and there can be cycles. So in some sense, you have connected the solutions. In the problem, in the original problem, the solution can be disconnected set of vertices, but by introducing one more dimension, one more degree of freedom, you have connected these solutions and now they look like this, set of paths and cycles. And we are interested in finding these vertices, endpoint of paths. Okay, so if we plug in y equals 0, then we obtain an infinite edge, endpoint of one path. And so Lemke's algorithm is to start from that endpoint by plugging y equals 0. So that is easy to find, and then follow the path. Because as I said that all the solutions are set of paths and cycles, so this just follow this path, and this is an infinite edge, so it will like just follow this path. And if you find g equals 0, like z equals 0 here, then that gives you a solution. But the problem here is that it may end up on another infinite edge. So in that case, you have not found a solution. So Lemke's algorithm is not guaranteed to give you a solution, even if there exists one. So to prove that it will give you a solution, you need to show that there are no rays, no other infinite edges. In that case, it has to converge to a solution. So to use the Lemke's algorithm, one needs to show there are no secondary rays. So it is unlike LP or something. Because like here, like you have to first formulate the problem as an LCP. But after that also, algorithm may not give you anything. So you need to do some technical work to prove that it will converge to a solution. It does not come free by just the LCP population. Okay, so let's come to the market. Markets with SPLC abilities, which is shown to be intractable. So what we did, we first formulated this problem as an LCP. So like, you might also be doing like, you take some problem and maybe formulating it as an LP or convex programming. So here we formulated it as an LCP, and as I said, the algorithm does not come free. So, but we prove that the algorithm will converge to a solution. And this is problem number 10, if you assume that the number of agents and number of goods are constant. If you assume any one of them to be constant, then it is a polynomial time algorithm. And we cannot hope to get better than this because this problem is intractable. And this algorithm also gives existence of equilibria, rationality, because all equilibrium prices are rational, odd number of equilibria, and it also shows containment in PPID. So this just, we obtain this as a corollary of our formulation and algorithm. Okay, so there are two challenges here. First, to formulate the market equilibrium problem as an LCP and then show that the algorithm will converge, meaning there are no secondary rails. So let's first try to formulate the market as an LCP. So we need to capture two things. One is the optimal bundle of agents and the market clearing. These are the two difficulties. These are the two constraints we need to capture through an LCP. So every agent brings, so these are the agents, these are the goods. So every agent brings some amount of goods. So let's say W11 denotes the amount of good one agent one brings to the market. So it can be zero also, it can be, so it is non-negative number. And the total supply is just use sum over like Wij over all agents. So total supply of goods is like sum over, like whoever brings the sum over this good among all the agents, and that is like total supply of this good in the market. And by without loss of generality, let's assume that it is 1. Total supply of every good is 1. So SPLC is little bit technical, so let me first show you for linear. Because linear there is only, it is easy. SPLC is like many segments. So let's first try to derive the LCP for linear case. So linear is like, let me remind you, linear is a utility like this. You have like a linear function for each good, and the total utility is sum over all these goods. So in this example, utility is like 1 into 1 times amount of mango and so on. So let's say this is the good J, and this constant can be anything, any non-negative number. Let's call this UJ. So everything in blue is like given to you. It's a input. So UJ is the rate of utility from good J, and the amount it consumes is, let's say, denoted by XJ. So total utility is like sum over all these goods, UJ time XJ. UJ time XJ is the utility from good J, and you just sum over all the goods. So that is the total utility agent I derives. So the utility function, linear utility functions are given by these numbers. So you have like how much, what is the rate of utility by consuming per unit of good J. So you have UIJ, these are the numbers given to you. It can be zero if you don't like to consume it, but it goes linear, like from the first unit UIJ, second unit UIJ. So this is the linear case. So let's write market clearing constraint. So we need to make sure that market clears. This is the one constraint we need to capture through LCP. So let's introduce variable PJ for price of goods J and QIJ for money spent on goods J by agent I. Because agent I may be buying some goods, let's say QIJ is the money agent I is giving to goods J. Okay, so for each good set, what we need to make sure, demand equals supply. We need to capture market equilibrium. We need to capture market equilibrium through LCP. So we need to capture demand equals supply for every good set. So let's say, what is the demand of good set? Demand is like QIJ is the money AZI is giving to good set. So QIJ upon PJ is the quantity AZI is taking. AZI is consuming of good set. So QIJ upon PJ is the amount that you are consuming AZI, and you just sum over all the agents. So this is the total demand of good set, and that should be equals to its supply, which we assume to be one. So this is the constant we will put in our LCP. So here, like, the summation does not depend on J, so it is a linear constant. So we are good. For the AZI, we need to consume. We need to capture spending equals earning, because you are not allowed to spend more than what you have. So spending is like QIJ money you are giving to good set. You just sum over all the goods. So it's like summation QIJ. And that should be equal to earning. WIJ is the amount of goods you brought to the market. WIJ times PJ is the money you can earn by selling this amount of good. And you just sum over all the goods. So this is also a linear concept. So market carrying, for market carrying, we have linear concept. So we can capture market carrying using these variables and these linear concepts. Okay, so now comes to the optimal bundle. We want to make sure everybody buys the most preferred bundle, which maximizes the utility function. So for that, UIJ upon PJ, what is this value? UIJ divided by PJ. UIJ is the rate of utility by consuming one unit of goods, and divided by its price is the utility you get by spending 1 rupee of your money. It's like utility per rupee. It's called bang per buck. And at optimal bundle, so you will see what are the prices of goods, and you will just compute UIJ upon PJ. That will give you what is the bang per buck from consuming this good. And if you want to maximize your utility function, your utility, total utility, so you will only spend your money on the maximum bang per buck goods, where your rate of utility is maximum. That will give you an optimal bundle. So if you are spending on some good QIJ greater than 0, then we want to make sure that UIJ upon PJ, that is the bang per buck from this good, should be maximum among all goods. So this is the constraint we need to capture through our LCP. So let's denote this maximum by 1 over lambda I. So this is like how we formulate the LCP. So let's denote this value by 1 over lambda I. And then what we want, that UIJ upon PJ, this is the bang per buck of goods here, should be at most the maximum bang per buck. So this is a linear constant. 1 over lambda I, because like if you simplify this, then it becomes linear. So that was the reason why we put 1 over lambda I here. So what here we are saying, that the bang per buck from goods here should be at most the maximum bang per buck. This is by the definition of 1 over lambda I. And what we want, that if your QIJ greater than 0, so this is a non-linear constant. What we are saying here that if QIJ is greater than 0, QIJ is positive, then this should be equality. Then this good J should be the giving you the maximum rate of utility. UIJ upon PJ equals 1 over lambda. So these two constraints satisfy our optimal bundle constraint. And by simplifying this, this is like this. This is linear constraint, and these are the complementarity constraint, which are hard. And in our notation, it becomes like this.
So, there can be multiple goods which have the
same bank product, yes. Same. Because the UIJ upon PJ can be, there can be many goods, and you are indifferent in consuming any of these goods. You can consume any one of these. So market algorithm can give you any good. You should be okay with that.
So, from the formulation, you have UIJ greater than 0 implies.
Yes.
Yeah. The line above. Yeah.
Yes.
So that maximum will occur. I mean, it's kind of unique, or it's not unique, but
the value is unique.
The value is unique.
Once the prices are given, this is a unique value, and there may be many goods which satisfy.
Which those are the different J's. Is it?
Okay, this is like a range over all the goods.
So that maximization is just dependent on I.
No, this depends on all the goods. K range, because
but the result is some function of.
So this depend on I. Yes, yes. Every agent will have different.
So what you're saying is QIJ greater than 0 implies UIJ over PJ is some 1 over lambda.
Yes.
So the J part is these are the ones that maximize this thing, right? There could be multiple J's which
yes.
have Qij greater than 0, but all of them will have Qij over Qj equal to 1.
Yes, that we ensured. We want to ensure that actually. And these constraints, if we put these constraints, that will ensure that. That here, like what we are saying, Qij greater than 0, then it should be equality, because otherwise, how will you get multiplication of these two equals 0?
The division among these maximum bank per buck does not matter. How much of, if two things give you the maximum bank per buck, do I get more of this or less?
Yeah, you are indifferent. So, the market can give you any.
All of those will appear as solutions.
Yeah, so it will be a convex solution. In fact, for linear, it has convex solutions. Yeah, of course. Yeah, very good point.
So you mentioned without loss of generality, we assume supply to be one unit from.
Yes.
That is not obvious to me. That
yeah. So
it seems a non-trivial.
Yeah, yeah. So what you do if you are given any supply? So it's like redefining the unit.
So it's a utility function.
So you have to move
the ratio of the supply. See, if you assume at equilibrium, each unit is one. So that will correspond to a particular utility function, transformation of a particular utility
yes,
function.
Yes, yes.
But initially, I have to choose between the space of different utility functions. Right? Here the utility function is fixed.
Yes.
If I am going to scale my utility function, then a priori I don't know which one to choose.
So you give me your market. So your market may have more than one supply of some good or less than one supply. So what I will do, I will convert it to another market where like I will make supply of H good to be one and I will modify UIJ. I will solve for this market and then from this solution I can get the solution here by the same, like whatever scaling I did here.
Right, so that is assuming I know the supply, the ratio of the supply is in the equilibrium.
No, the supply is fixed, supply is part of input. So this is the part of input. So it's like, it's the extent system.
So input is the supply and the determinant is the price.
Input is the supply at the utility function. And then the output is the equilibrium prices and the allocation.
Supply is
yeah, supply
so
is given.
The market will determine how much to bring to supply. That's not.
Yeah, that's not. Yeah. So this is like once the supply is given, mm-hmm. then you can do it. So now we can. So using market trading and optimal bundle constraint, we have an LCP for linear case, and this was given by Eves in 1975. And he also said that also under study, he also studied piecewise linear utilities and production. And if successful, this avenue could prove important in real economic modeling. So he made this program open and he kind of extended his algorithm to separable piecewise linear complex utility function when there are more segments. Okay, so let me not go into the proof details. So now you have segments. So you have pieces, like for each utility function, you have many pieces. In linear, there was only one red. Now you have different red. And every, so he can like, let's say UIJ, so every segment has two parameters. One is the rate of the utility you derive on this segment, and one is the maximum amount you can consume on this segment, the length of the segment. And we want to put that QIJK. The money spent on this segment should not be more than LIJK times PJ, because this is just coming from the input. LIJK is the maximum amount you can consume on this segment, and LIJK times PJ is the money you are spending on this segment. So this is easy constraint. So the difficulty here is like, let me just tell you about the difficulty. Difficulty in capturing optimal bundle. Market clearing is okay. Market clearing you can get easily by extending linear case. But in optimal bundle, we need to make sure that if you are allocating some money on the second segment, then the first segment should be fully allocated. Because you want to consume maximum, like first you want to consume first segment and the second segment. So we want to capture these things as an LCP, some like, complementarity and linear constraints. So this is the difficulty, and for this we introduce new price supplement variables for each segment and use complementarity carefully. So this is non-trivial part to capture optimal bundle. And there are some other problems which, but this is the most challenging one to get an LCP formulation. So we get an LCP formulation for SPLC, and we show that solutions of this LCP is same in market equilibrium. So we got the LCP formulation, and then now what about the algorithm? So we can apply that algorithm, Lemke's algorithm, which I discussed. But it does not converge to a solution. It may not converge to a solution. It may converge to another ray. So we prove that there are no such rays.
in the polyhedron. So whenever you will start from the y equals 0, it will converge to a solution. So this is a highly technical part of the paper to prove that it will converge to a solution. And so it settles open questions of Eves from 1975. It also settles open question of Vajrani and Anakakis by showing membership in PPAD. And it is strongly polynomial. So it's polynomial if you assume that the number of goods or number of agents are constant. And it is fast in practice. It is like simplex algorithm of linear programming. So we have implemented this algorithm and ran on randomly generated instances, and we found that it works very fast, linear in the number of variables. And like some people from CMU, they have some network problem where they have to price the edges of the network. They are using our algorithm for, maybe they can model their utility function as a separable piece by linear control. And in fact, this is only for like randomly generated instances, but we want to apply it to more practical scenarios where you can model the utility function and you want to price something. So those kind of problems there you can use this kind of this algorithm. The problem is intractable, but algorithm works very fast.
Which paper was that?
This is Stock 2012 with Ruta Mehta, Milind Soni and Vijay Bajrani. And then we extend this algorithm to include production also. So I have not talked about markets with production. So when there are production firms, then they can take some raw material from the market and produce some good. And they want to maximize their profit. So if you include production also, then we extend this algorithm to production. And later we extend to non-separable utility function also, which we call Leontief tree. So PLC is like harder, so we could extend these things to Leontief tree, which contains many nice utility functions, which cannot be captured by SPLC, where you allow non-separability. Okay, so quickly.
In the production case, the produced good are not coming back to this market.
No, produced good has to be consumed.
So then the supply is not fixed.
Yes, their supply is not fixed. Then it's like whatever initial bundle agents are bringing, whatever is the production is happening, equals agents are consuming directly or the firms are consuming it. So you have to, yeah.
So it's strictly a more general problem.
Yes. That is
the difficulty. It's a more general problem. Yes. Than
so it is, that is the difficulty because supply is not fixed. So, So any more questions on algorithm? So next I move to hardness result. So what we show that Leontief markets are hard. Leontief means like I'll define it. So markets can do arithmetic. That's how we show it. So Leontief function is like this, where you want to consume goods on fixed proportion. Like our example of mango and apple. If you want to have a juice for mango and apple together, then you want to buy them together. Or charger or iPad. Or like sandwich, if you want to consume a sandwich, like you need two slices of bread and one slice of cheese. You want to consume cheese sandwich. So this is the utility function, which is called Leontief function. So we relate the computing market equilibrium in Leontief where the agent's utility functions are Leontief to multivariate polynomials. So here the problem is like you are given multivariate polynomials. So multivariate polynomials means there are variables and there are like many set of these polynomials. And the problem is to find the simultaneous zero of these polynomials. And this is known to be notoriously hard p-space problem. In fact, it was not even decidable before 67. So Tarski said this problem is decidable. Then Kenny in 88 proved that it is decidable p-space. So this is very hard problem. So what?
Over reals,
yes. So here like you want x over reals. So what we show, we take such a system of polynomials. So you have such a system of polynomials. So we convert these polynomials into a market. So we take polynomials, we construct a market where each agent utility function is Leontief. Very simple. Each agent wants some goods in equal proportion. Those kind of things. And the variable in the multivariate polynomials is good here. So that will be captured through price of good. So for each variable there will be a good, and like the value of this variable will be captured through price of this good. And we want to make sure that we show that solutions of the set of multivariate polynomials are same as equilibrium prices of the market. So this is the reduction we get. Okay, so I'll just briefly tell you about the reduction. So the basic building block of the multivariate polynomials are these two functions. You have a linear function where like these b, c and d are constant. So this is a linear polynomial and a quadratic polynomial. And using these two, you can build any polynomial. So what we do, we want to capture these variables to price of some good, and we want to make sure that at equilibrium, these prices enforces these relation, what we want to. So like if it enforces these relation, either linear or quadratic. So any system of polynomials can be converted into these two set of polynomials. So how we do it? So addition is simpler. So what is this? You have three goods. You want to make sure the price of first good is addition of second and third good. That is kind of you want to make sure in the market. So that is easy. That looks natural also, because you want to buy two goods together, like because you want to anyway is the complementary goods like cheese and the bread. And if you bundle these markets and create another good, cheese sandwich. So the price of cheese sandwich is equal to price of cheese plus price of bread. So doing addition is like it's a natural thing and it's simple. So here, like suppose there are two agents. He brings mango and she brings apple and orange. And he wants to consume apple and orange, and she wants to consume mango. Then like this will enforce this linear relation. Then only they will reach to equilibrium, because she doesn't want to consume mango, any of these things, and he doesn't want to consume mango. But suppose there is the one difficulty here is that these polynomials, they have common variables. So you have system of polynomials and there are common variables in different polynomials. So if we write market for one polynomial, so there will be a variable for some price. There will be some price variable for some variable here in the polynomial. And the same price will be appearing in the different market. So what we do, we create a market for each polynomial, but now they are interfering because same good is appearing in different markets. It's like Pawai market, Washi market, like that. And we want to make sure that like they maintain these the same price, because it is the same variable. So that is the difficulty. So here is like if there is another market where she has mango, then this relation may not be satisfied, because she will interfere with the market carrying concern in this sub market. I hope I made it clear. But so what we do? So how to ensure that like there are no extra supply? You take a polynomial and convert into a market, and take another polynomial and convert into another market, and you then take all of them together, all the markets together, and give as a reduction. Okay, so for that, like we introduce a notion of closed sub market, where like there are no flows in different markets. So we create a market here, and it is independent of itself. There is no flow from this market to another market. Even though when we will consider all of them together, it satisfies this property. That is the difficulty. And of course, multiplication is very, very difficult. How you make sure that the price of some good is like price of multiplication of price of two other goods? This does not look natural also. How to make sure that in the market? So this is very challenging, and we have many gadgets which make sure that we can get a market which can do these kind of multiplication.
Is this exact or is approximate?
Exact.
What are these things here?
So these are gadgets. So these here you have to create a market, some agents and goods. So here like what it does is that input to this gadget is like good G1 whose quantity is 1 and the price is P. And we want output from this market is like price is 1 and quantity is P. We are like converting supply into prices. So if you want to multiply two prices, you have to convert one price into supply at some point, because then only this quantity someone will consume, and that person will pay like this quantity times its prices. So we get multiplication of these prices.
So this is what you call production earlier.
No, no, this is not production. Here, like, you have to create a market inside it, like some number of agents and some number of goods, which take this good, whose price is P and quantity is 1, and leave and consume among themselves something, and they leave to the other market. So this is a small market, part of a big market. And leave to the market another good G2, whose price is 1 and the quantity P. So it's like converting, reversing these, like supply and price to price and supply. And this is like combiner, which takes two goods and combine the price of two goods. This is splitter, it's like opposite of this. And we put them in this format, and like, because we need to also make sure the closeness property, that there is no flow outside this market. So that makes it more difficult.
So what does it mean? This means you're solving multiple sub-market problems to arrive at the overall market problem.
Yeah, so what we do, we take polynomial and we get a market. We take another polynomial and get a market. And then we combine all these together and form a big market. And the difficulty is that it's common variables in different polynomials. So here, like, common goods. So how to make sure that these, like, supply constraints, supply demand constraints, not interfering between these two sub-markets. So for this, we introduce closure.
We have to transmit the price.
Because we need to take them as one market. You just add all the assets, all the goods, and that is one market. Okay, so I think I'm running out of time, so maybe we can discuss this work. So Lyapunov markets can solve a system of multiple polynomial equations, and we get hardness for that. And some of my other work, so recently I've done some work in resolved many open questions in market equilibrium. So we had like complexity of approximate market equilibrium. So this is like very recent work. And some dynamics question, atomic dynamics, I mentioned some dynamics in the beginning. You start with some prices and then increase the price if the demand is more than supply. So the question is like how fast it will converge. So in computer science we studied like it will converge in polynomial time or what is the rate of convergence. So we prove the past convergence which improves upon the previous convergence. It resolves many other problems also. And then I have done some learning utility function. We put utility in my talk, we assume that they are given to you. But like, if it is not given to you, then you have to learn, because these are the private values. So what is the query complexity of learning these utility functions? Because you offer, like what we do, you offer some prices and get the demand. And can you interpret something about something from this demand? Maybe you need to give multiple set of prices and multiple set of demands, and finally you have to come up with, oh, this person has this utility function. So those kind of query complexity we study, lower bound and upper bound on that. How many queries you require? And here, like this, I think master asked, like piecewise Leontief concave utilities. So here, like Leontief does not satisfy diminishing marginal returns. It's like just you need goods in fixed proportion, but like if you scale the input bundle, your utility scales. So I define a new utility function where like it decreases also. Till some amount, it is some red. It's after that the red decreases. So like this, and you can change the ratio also. And then I study algorithmic and hardness results for that. So I proved that like if the ratio remains same, then it is polynomial time. If the ratio is different, then it becomes hard. And then some work on market production and so here like we to okay let me know. So this is the work I'm currently doing. So one is the smooth analysis of complementary pivot algorithm. So this is the framework we given by Spielman and Tang for simplex algorithm. So simplex algorithm runs very fast in practice, but in the worst case they are exponential time algorithm. So they proved that smooth complexity of simplex is polynomial time. And same thing is happening in complementary pivot algorithm. Because like worst case it will be exponential, but we have many algorithms, complementary pivot algorithm, and all of them perform very fast in practice on the randomly generated instances. So there has to be some reason for that. So that will explain that why they run faster than this. And the status of PPAD, so there are many open problems in PPAD, like P-matrix NCP, coordination games. There are many games and markets which the problems are not known to be in polynomial time, but like, and not known to be hard also. So they are lying between polynomial time and hardness.
strongly polynomial algorithm for LP, linear programming. So strongly polynomial means like number of iteration depends on only on the size of the matrix, like number of inequalities and number of variables. And of course, the last thing, like more interesting, market algorithms for other setting. I want to apply these algorithms for other setting, like modeling toll, pricing of, like how to price it, tolls and other setting. Because like market is like MCMU, those people are anyway using on the ones of network problems. Okay. So thanks for the attention and thank you for the collaborators.
Today's markets, electronic markets, are typically dynamic pricing things.
Okay.
Any of these lead any suggestions for that?
Dynamic pricing, like
spectrum. Price changes with time and
yeah.
And how many units get sold in a certain
interval
of time.
I think there is a theory, but I think not from algorithmic side. But there are models for that.
Do any of these lead to any solutions there which are new compared to the
So I like these are very recent ones. We have not applied to these settings, but like it will be very interesting to I think to see if we can get something there. Because the market model is very general, you can have good for with time and location.
And
the issue
is perishability.
Perishable, non-perishable goods. Yes. Sir. I think TCS, like theoretical computation, the CS community has not like currently looked at these problems. These are like very recent, but last 5 years.
So in the real world markets are kind of people making distributed decisions, right? There's no central authority doing this. So is there any direct practical use for something which solves
the market? This is like this is centralized algorithm. This is like doing centrally. There is very another dynamic work distributed, like where you are like changing the market parameters with time and how the equilibrium is going. So there is another dynamic work. Like settlement is like that, and how the prices are evolving. So I think so this is used in policy analysis. Like US government or economists, they use for policy analysis, how to price something, where to put taxes, what to do, just to understand how the equilibrium changes. And more recently, we are like there are many uses in scheduling and resource allocation. Because like market gives efficient and fair solution, fair allocation. So more recently, like if you want to allocate some items to some agents, where you want to maximize the minimum valuation, minimum happiness, then how to allocate them. So these problems are NP-hard problem in general. But using market algorithms now you can compute them and then you can round them. So they give like and there are many like good results, like two approximations. And scheduling, like you want to assign jobs to the processor, like how to do that. So that like everybody is like having some, you want to maximize the minimum time. So everywhere like if these problems can be formulated as market problems. Wherever you are like you want to price something.
Can you give an intuition about the way you formulated the constraint that the first segment should have been extinguished before you move to the second segment? You move over that segment.
Yes. So what you need to use complementarity. So we use one more variable, and we somehow, it's not easy to I think convey like this, but okay. But it's like one more variable, and we put them in such a way using complementarity, that if it is greater than 0, then it should be equality and like this, such that finally it comes out to be like that. Like if the k minus 1 segment is like, if you have some flow on k segment with k minus, all the 1 to k minus 1 are fully open. So using complementarity, we can do it. And some more variables you need to do this.
So suppose there is a distributed market.
Yes.
And I have a trader in one of the locations. And suppose I get the information about the entire market and I use an algorithm such as yours to get an equilibrium condition.
Right.
So the distributed market may arrive at a different equilibrium puzzle, right? But will this computation give me any kind of a commercial advantage? That knowing that there is this solution, will it help me?
Yeah, I think we don't have anything better than this. I think that's what I will say. There's no other model like this can. So this is the only thing we have. So maybe it may not give you something very, very nice, but this will give you something. So we need to, I think, model the problem maybe separately. Maybe it will be reduced to this model. Most of the time it reduces like finance market, everything reduces to this market model.
So the solutions may not be unique, but are they close by or nothing like that is also
unique? Even like, yeah, that is one more problem here. Like, equilibria are not unique. There exist one, but there may be many.
And they may be very far away.
Very far away, yeah. The same problem is in GAMS.
Yeah.
So
the impact to the equilibrium,
yes, yes, yes. So policy analysis, like they use, traditionally it has been used in policy analysis, like how to put taxes or how to design these things so that it can move the people in some particular direction. You want to enforce some behavior actually. It's like mechanism design. Like. You can use these.
So analyzing the change in equilibrium is going to be a more important problem than.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
For fact, but very nice.
The equilibrium condition,
right?
That is relaxed.
Approximate equilibrium, let's say.
Means demand equal to supply, or what a market equilibrium condition may not always happen.
Yeah, yeah.
So then, how can that has to be modeled? Does that change the
condition? So you allow some slack in those right. conditions.
So, I mean, in realistic settings, there might be
yes.
monopoly or voting or whatever. So then, if demand doesn't meet supply, or that market equilibrium condition doesn't happen.
I think if it is not like if it is just additive factor, then I think it won't matter because it will be very small compared to the supply, the huge volume you are considering. But if it is additive, multiplicative, like some fraction, like 10% of the supply, maybe, like, may not, then maybe.
But supposing you give a value for it to your producer, I'm making oil, but I have a value for avoiding it.
Yeah.
Then. The demand could be made equal to supply by me consuming my
right.
So, is that?
Yeah.
Or even the other way around, they have a smaller demand than supply. Your goal is to maximize the demand as close as possible to the supply. Like airline seats. Pricing for making sure that the seats flow well.
Right.
So, there could be another constraint of minimization of that difference between supply and demand.
Yeah, I think, yeah, all these are nice, but I think demand equal supply is, I think, fine, because it's like, then you are anyway earning from, what if you are not selling some item, you are like throwing it away, then maybe you will not, like,
time varying,
so it is like, generally, like, of course, there is always some like, relaxation, some slackness, but market operates at equilibrium because, like, it will automatically make it,
the production model will allow for some modeling room for, you know, modeling carryover.
Okay.
So the production model will allow you to carry over that, you know, today's production and tomorrow's production may be two different goods.
Yes.
So then you can have that carryover.
So the utility for tomorrow's goods is
so you put that. So the markets of production, remember, they have, there is a time you can allow that. A good produce today and a good produce
tomorrow. So this is, I think, very fundamental model. Like you have to generalize these things for the specific setting.
So in the network example that you talked about,
yes,
or you said that people have implemented.
Yeah.
So each communication link is a separate good or something like that.
Yes. You need to price that communication.
So there are many goods.
Yes.
Are there more questions? So
there's
time to
go in.
Slow.
Yeah, outside.